Hello, everyone. Out here in the barn studio, and January 29th. I'm not going to read the text today, but there are a few things happening in the world that are noteworthy. Yesterday, President Trump unveiled his deal of the century to bring the Palestinians and Israelis together in peace. I think the term that they used yesterday, peace, prosperity, and security. But I wanted to read this little article that appeared in Russian newspaper TASS. And this was the Russian ambassador to the United States. He's calling for the leaders of the five permanent members of the United Nations Security Council, which would be Russia, China, United Kingdom, the United States, and France, to gather for a meeting in May or September, which would coincide with either the Nuclear Non-Proliferation Treaty review in May or the 75th anniversary of the United Nations Organization in September. Well, so what? They have meetings all the time. Well, he says he thinks the implementation of this initiative would be very useful for international peace and security. Wow. They've been talking about peace and security for years and years. Nothing ever happened. Well, they've been talking about Jesus Christ coming, and nothing has happened either, right? Doesn't mean something isn't going to happen. It doesn't mean Jesus is not going to come. Things are seeming to line up. And the United States has almost committed itself to igniting a war. It's funny because Donald Trump just tweeted this morning, as you know, in this impeachment thing, one of his former national security advisor is now, you know, coming out with a book and may testify in the impeachment hearings that he's got the goods on the president. And the president, he's funny. He said, if I would have listened to his advice, we'd be in World War VI already. Well, he's of course exaggerating, because World War III would be the end of it, wouldn't it? There wouldn't be a 4, 5, or 6. But with this coronavirus, which could become this global pandemic that the world seems to have avoided for 100 years since the last Spanish flu killed, you know, some say 100 million. It's incredible. And the scary thing is there are only a little more than a billion people living back then, and now the world is crammed with 8 billion. And it makes no sense to me, but there are tens of thousands of Chinese who are getting on a plane every day and flying all around the world. And why they haven't locked all that down, maybe they want a global pandemic. I don't know. Somebody might, and somebody surely wants a big war too. So, and I've spoken about this, but you know, to save the world from global warming, the governor of the Bank of England announced that all the top banks, like 1,000 banks, are all on board that they're not going to loan any more money to companies that produce greenhouse gases. You might cheer and say, yeah, that's a good thing. We no more. Well, farm tractors produce a lot of greenhouse gas. Semi-trailer trucks that, lorries, if you will, that bring food from farm to market, they produce CO2 and a lot of other noxious gases. So there's your food shortage. It's built into the financial system. And that's not even counting if the whole thing crashes. So we've got the horses of the apocalypse champing at the bit, as it were. I'm just doing my job. You watchmen, that's right. That's what I'm supposed to do. I've got some questions here that actually from the same questioner, a couple of questions. And I apologize for not getting to these earlier. It's been a couple of weeks, 3 weeks maybe. He's read my book, Jehovah Has Become King. His question is, when the 7,000 chosen ones shine brightly, is this figurative or an actual physical supernatural event that the world will see? Will they physically be radiating light the same as Moses did? Well, you know, I've thought a lot about that question myself. And I think it will be a literal, observable phenomenon. Just as I think that Jesus will visibly manifest himself to the chosen ones. Search the scriptures from end to end. You will not find any expression of the invisible presence of Christ. That negates the very meaning of manifestation, of revelation. And, of course, the parousia, it literally means to come alongside. So you would think if Jesus comes alongside those who belong to him, that they would know it. It wouldn't have to be calculated, you know, the seven times, and, you know, and we think Jesus is here somewhere. I mean, keep in mind, the Watchtower originally said that the parousia began in 1874. And they believed that all the way up until 1930. And then they readjusted it, kicked it back to 1914. But if Jesus was present in 1874, and they were convinced of it, and published reams and reams talking about the presence of Christ, and now it's suddenly something that didn't exist. It was a hoax. But now we're to believe that the parousia has been ongoing from 1914. I won't get into that, but there is the account about Stephen. And you might say he was one of the first of seven ministerial servants who were chosen. Do you remember in the account there? And I think it's the sixth chapter of Acts. The Greek-speaking widows were being overlooked in the daily distribution. And so the apostle said, you know, we don't want to take our time away from preaching. Let's set these qualified men up and in charge of that. Well, it says Stephen was full of Holy Spirit and power. And in his disputing with various ones, they couldn't hold their own, so they falsely accused him, hauled him before the Sanhedrin. The high priest said, are these things really so? Well, in that process, Stephen stood before the high court of Israel, and it said his face took on the appearance of an angel's face. We don't know what that may have entailed, but it was some sort of supernatural appearance. And Stephen launched into this history of Israel. Mind you, he's full of Holy Spirit. Didn't Jesus say that the chosen ones will stand before governors and kings in a court-like setting? And Jesus said, what you're going to say, do not rehearse beforehand. What you will say will be given you in that hour by the Holy Spirit. So Stephen is acting this out. And keep in mind that Paul stood before governors. He stood before Festus. He stood before the emperor of Rome, apparently, Caesar. But there's no indication that Paul took on the appearance of an angel's face. So what we're dealing with Stephen is a portent. Huh? So after Stephen gave the history of Israel leading up to the Messiah, then he let the Jews have it, so to speak. He said, your forefathers killed the prophets and you have murdered the Son of God. And they couldn't take it. They put their hands over their ears and they rushed upon him, drug him out, and started stoning him to death. Before that, he looked up and saw it. The heavens opened up. He saw God on his throne and Jesus at his right hand. And that's when they killed him. So what Stephen really saw was Jesus Christ in his sitting on his throne, coming in his kingdom power. And Stephen enacted what the chosen ones will do during that time of the end, when they stand before governors and kings and give them a witness, not an opportunity really for salvation, but let them know the truth about God and Christ and all of that. So in the first letter of John, he spoke about the manifestation of Christ. And he says, as of yet, we don't know what we will be like. But when we see him, we shall be like him. He said, when he is manifest, we shall be like him. Well, Jesus is not going to manifest himself in heaven. He's already manifest in heaven. He's not concealed from the angels. The apostle was talking about literally seeing some manifestation of Jesus. You can't see him exactly as he is in the flesh, apparently. It would be too glorious, just as you can't see Jehovah. But a manifestation is some supernatural revelation, a manifestation, where you know you've seen something extraordinary. And as the questioner indicated, Moses came down from the mountain and his face was aglow. He had to put a veil over his face because the Israelites were just freaked out. Look at this guy with his face glowing. And Paul said that, again, in the Corinthians, he said that we are speaking with unveiled faces, representing the glory of God. Well, again, there's no indication that Christians in the first century had an angel's face or took on some supernatural glow. But the apostle spoke of himself as living during the time of the parousia. For example, he says, we the living who survive to the presence. And he also spoke regarding the man of lawlessness. He said that, don't be unduly alarmed by letters as though from us, as if the apostles were living during that time as well. And it's just an indication that the Word of God is alive. And so I think it will be a literal physical manifestation of those chosen ones. Not necessarily to the world, though, because when Jesus was resurrected, he manifested himself, of course, in the flesh. It wasn't a supernatural demonstration. In fact, the apostles didn't recognize him. They just thought he was some guy. You know, Mary mistook him for a gardener. And the two disciples that were walking on the road to Emmaus, and a man came along, what are you talking about? And they said, you've been living in an alien place? You don't know what's been happening with this man named Jesus? And then he started talking to them, opening up their hearts. But they didn't recognize him. But anyway, after Jesus was resurrected, he appeared to some 500 people until the moment he was lifted up. But all of those individuals, every one of them, was a believer before Jesus died. So Jesus did not manifest himself to any unbelievers. And Jesus himself said, "The world will behold me no more, but you will behold me." Well, the watchtower says, yeah, that's in when they go to heaven. Well, in that same context, Jesus said, "I am coming again to you." So isn't it logical that that is when they would see him, when he comes to them to take them home? It makes sense that, you know, the view that the watchtower has laid out, the book of Revelation has all been fulfilled, and all that is left is, of course, Babylon the Great going down, and then Armageddon. And true enough, that will be a big, you know, display of supernatural power. But that destructive aspect doesn't really, it doesn't really justify God, you know, in wiping the world out. I mean, God has been so tolerant and patient for all of these thousands of years. Why will he suddenly go off and destroy the world? There's something that happens leading up to that. And that's what the Watchtower and Jehovah's Witnesses cannot appreciate yet. We're working on them, though. Let me see here. I should open this up before. Now, for those of you who may not be all that familiar with why the questioner talked about the 7,000, it's mentioned in Revelation in the 11th chapter. And I've applied it to the chosen ones. There will be 7,000 during that 42-month period when the two witnesses give their testimony before the world. And of course, that number came up in connection with Elijah, to remember when he was hiding out from wicked King Ahab and Jezebel, and he said that he was the only one left, and Jehovah corrected him. He said, "No, I have 7,000 who have not bent their knee to Baal or kissed his image." And Paul, again, in Romans, alluded to that, saying that at this particular time, 7,000, a remnant of 7,000 have appeared. So now in Revelation, we find this 7,000 number again, and it's quite interesting. I did a video on the two witnesses some time ago, so I won't go into that too much, but only to say that I believe the two witnesses represent the totality of the chosen ones, whereas the 7,000 represent the individuals in that body of Christ at that time. And they will be sealed. In other words, they will be granted entry into the kingdom. And that's when they will shine as brightly as the sun in the kingdom of their Father while they're on the earth after their sealing. Now, okay, so in verse 9 and 10, the two witnesses are killed. And then verse 11, after 3.5 days, Spirit of life from God entered into them, and they stood on their feet, and they heard a voice in heaven say, "Come up here." So that's the resurrection of the remaining ones. After 3.5 days, it doesn't mean they're literally dead for 3.5 days. They're instantaneously changed into immortal spirits. Paul said, in the twinkling of an eye. But it evokes the death of Christ. He was in the grave for parts of 3 days and then resurrected. But here in verse 13, this is all ties in. In that hour, there was a great earthquake, and a tenth of the city fell, and 7,000 persons were killed by the earthquake, and the rest became frightened and gave glory to the God of heaven. Well, that was the second woe. It says, look, the third woe is coming quickly. And the seventh angel blew his trumpet, and there were loud voices in heaven saying, the kingdom of the world has become the kingdom of our Lord and of his Christ, and he will rule as king forever and ever. Well, why does the kingdom, why is it said to come to power right after this great earthquake and the 7,000 are killed? Well, it's not a literal earthquake, mind you. Again, it evokes the death of Jesus. When Jesus breathed his last, there was a great earthquake, right? Corpses from tombs were thrown up and visible. Very, very strange situation. So just as the 3.5 days they came to life, the earthquake is again evoking the death of Christ. And this, we're talking about the body of Christ, goes through the same ordeal, death at the hands of persecutors. Yeah, that's why it says that when they, in verse 7, after they've finished their witnessing, the wild beast that ascends out of the abyss will wage war with them and kill them. And their corpses will be on the main street of the great city that is in a spiritual sense called Sodom and Egypt, where their Lord was also executed on the stake. So a lot of the Christians were, of course, murdered in the first century. And when Christianity concludes, all of these 7,000 are going to be killed. That's why with the opening of the fifth seal, those dead in Christ said, "When are you going to avenge our blood?" And the angel says, "Just a little while longer, until the rest, your brothers who are about to be killed, are killed." So that's why the kingdom is spoken of with the blowing of the seventh trumpet. The kingdom comes to power then, because all 144,000 will be in heaven with Christ. God's purpose will be accomplished with the death of the 7,000 remaining ones. So let's go back to the second question here. And this is related as well. It says, regarding the two-thirds that will be cut off, does this mean that only one-third of Jehovah's Witnesses will form the great crowd and the rest will be destroyed? If that is so, is 2 million actually a great crowd? Well, he's referring to the 13th chapter of Zechariah, which I refer to Zechariah sort of as the Hebrew revelation, because it ties in quite a bit. The 13th chapter, it concludes with, Jehovah says, two parts in the land will be cut off and perish, and a third of it will be left remaining. And I will bring the third part through the fire, and I will refine them as silver is refined, and test them as gold is tested. Well, that reminds us of Malachi, the third chapter, doesn't it? The messenger of the covenant comes with the lie of a laundryman and the fire of a refiner. The Watchtower says that happened back in 1918. So we're all refined now. Even though all those people living back then that were supposedly refined, they're all dead. And now Jehovah's Witnesses that supposedly, have established pure worship at last. Obviously, there is only one refining. And it's interesting, too, if you go consider that entire 13th chapter of Zechariah. The Watchtower, of course, claims to be the voice of the prophet class. You know, it's come up with terms like the Jeremiah class, the Ezekiel class, on and on. And verse 2, he says, "I will erase the names of the idols from the land, and they will no longer be remembered, and I will rid the land of the prophets and the spirit of uncleanness. And if a man should prophesy again, his father and his mother who caused his birth will say to him, you will not live, because you have spoken lies in the name of Jehovah. And his father and his mother who caused his birth will pierce him through because of his prophesying. In that day, each of the prophets, so-called, will be ashamed of his vision when he prophesies, and they will not wear an official garment of hair in order to deceive. And he will say, I'm no prophet. I'm a man cultivating the soil because a man bought me when I was young. Well, anyway, I think I did a video on that too, didn't I? The prophets will be ashamed. But yeah, just think, when Christ actually comes, and here the Watchtower has been saying, yeah, he came in 1914, the kingdom has come. You know, they published a book a few years ago, you know, 100 years of kingdom rule. And that's all going to blow up in their face. They'll have no credibility. Jehovah has, you know, he's been tolerant because he allows for this delusion. But then if anyone prophesies after that, during the presence of Christ, in order to deceive, and Jesus said there would be many, many false prophets will arise. The Christ is here. He's in the wilderness. He's in the inner chambers. Jesus said, don't believe them. They're liars, deceivers. And they will receive the punishment of everlasting death. So their father and their mother who gave them birth, in a sense, that's Jehovah and the covenant woman. There are those who are anointed who will prove to be false. And it's interesting going back to the 7,000. The numbers out for the last memorial said that there were 19,000 some partakers. And that's quite interesting, because maybe this year there'll be 21,000, who knows? So 7,000 would be a third of 21,000. What Jehovah is speaking about is not the great crowd, but it's Jerusalem. Jerusalem is the congregation of the firstborn, essentially. The new Jerusalem that comes down from heaven is the 144,000 in Christ that are going to rule. Prior to that time, I should go back to Revelation. Remember the great earthquake, it caused a tenth of the city to fall. 10 and tenth are used to symbolize the earthly. So the earthly congregation of Christ will no longer exist, because there will no longer be any members of the congregation of the firstborn on earth once the 7,000 pass away. So that's the end of Christianity. It will have accomplished its purpose. So, yeah, this is interesting in verse 7. O sword, awake against my shepherd, against the man who is my companion. Strike the shepherd and let the flock be scattered. And I will turn my hand against those who are insignificant. Well, the apostles applied that originally to the death of Jesus. He was a shepherd, and of course he was taken for them, struck, and the apostles were all scattered. But in the context here, it's speaking about the second coming. It's kind of like 3D chess, you know, these greater and smaller fulfillments. And that's when Jehovah says, in all the land, two parts of it will be cut off. And those who are refined and tested, it says, they will call on my name, and I will answer them, and I will say, they are my people. And they will say, Jehovah is our God. That expression means that when Jehovah says, they are my people, that's what he says in Revelation 21:4. That means that he has finally given his approval to both the little flock and the great crowd. And there's no more testing, no more refining, no more eliminating the liars and the deceivers and those who are false. And then we get into the next chapter, chapter 14. That's the last chapter of Zechariah. And this is talking about the final war. The day is coming, a day belonging to Jehovah. And he says, I will gather all the nations against Jerusalem for the war. And the city will be captured, and the houses plundered, and the women raped, and so on. And Jehovah will go out and war against those nations as when he fights in the day of battle. In that day, his feet will stand on the Mount of Olives, which faces Jerusalem on the east. So, some poor Trinitarians, they say, see, Jesus is coming back, but here it says Jehovah. So, you can't reason with somebody who reasons that way. But Jesus is coming in the name of his Father, just as he did in the first century. And the significance of the Mount of Olives, that is where Jesus spoke to his disciples. Remember, when they tell us, when will these things be? He was sitting on the Mount of Olives, looking down on the city and the temple. And when he ascended back to heaven, the apostles were on the Mount of Olives. Because in Acts it says they came back to Jerusalem from the Mount of Olives after Jesus had ascended. So the angel said, just as you have seen him ascend, he will come back in the same manner. So referring to him coming down on the Mount of Olives is simply a symbolic way of referring to Jesus coming back to the earth from the place where he left, not in a literal sense. The Bible is a book of symbolism. So, yeah, so this final attack on Jerusalem is what provokes God's wrath. And the killing of Jesus' brothers, who are at that point as dear to God as Christ himself. That's why Jesus said, you do it to the least of these, my brothers, you're doing it to me. So 7,000 sons of God killed, do you think that's not going to provoke a reaction? That justifies God in annihilating the world. Game over. So I think that'll do it for today. Hopefully see you tomorrow.